Mike, welcome.
Thanks, Paul.
So look, it's been almost 8 years since you've been with Seeing Machines, and you know, your role's evolved a fair bit since you first started heading up Human Factors, and now leading our whole innovation team and strategy. You know, what are you focused on today? What are the big rocks?
Yeah, look, so today we're absolutely focused on the next wave of automotive RFQs, you know, really the next 6 months, 12 months. And, you know, not surprisingly, it's pretty heavily geared around safety, you know, with what's happening with the regulations. So distraction, drowsiness, being long-standing road safety issues, but also the emerging safety issues like driver engagement that come into play with assisted driving or level two driving, as some people call it. But, you know, we also have a really keen eye on the future. Mm. You know, we are engaged in a lot of advanced R&D to make sure that we're positioned well for success beyond the current wave of RFQs. Mm. And that's advanced research in our human factors areas, whether it's new concepts, new ways of detecting operator state, our optical science, and really developing advances and efficiencies in the optical path. And of course, embedding, you know, and we see this growing demand that's got to fit on a smaller footprint. And so that advanced R&D around how we deliver that more efficiently, you know, I think we used to say time is money, and I think in our game, from an R&D perspective, it's sort of, you know, algorithm model size and efficiency is money.
Yeah, yeah. Look, it seems to be getting more and more complicated, doesn't it, as we move forward. Right now we've got a lot of RFQs still in our pipeline to be won. That takes a lot of effort, and the requirements of OEMs at this point in the cycle are still wide and varied. And we've, of course, won a significant volume of RFQs with new customers. So where do you see the big pull or the big effort? You know, is it in features? I mean, where are the challenges? Where are some of the real, you know, technical areas of focus for the team here?
I think there's two key areas, really briefly. You know, one is around safety, and I repeat this again, because DMS, effective DMS, is not a beeping box, right? It's not a coffee cup light. This is a signal that our automotive, aviation, fleet customers want to digest, and they want, you know, if I'm distracted, then that information will be used to change other vehicle systems, the forward collision warning system, the lane departure warning system. So the bar on safety is just continually going up and up because of what's at stake. In addition to that, we are seeing this explosion, obviously, in you know, customers wanting to know more about what's the driver doing, what are other occupants doing, you know, are they holding something, are they reaching, are they in their seat? And really, this is, from our viewpoint in innovation, you know, an explosion. As customers look to differentiate, and you know, we're really pleased to be able to support their innovation and differentiation. And it's sort of like this continued pathway to a holistic safe driving experience.
Yeah. So the regulators have a big role to play here. Of course, they're pushing the take-up rate of the technology, and with a camera in place, the OEMs are now requiring more and more utility out of that camera, driving features. But if you look at our kind of the part of our business that we tend to talk about less in terms of features, which is aftermarket, you know, we're starting to have engagement there on truck and bus manufacturers, particularly in Europe, as you know, Euro NCAP is demanding that they respond in the same way as passenger vehicle manufacturers. What are you seeing there, both in terms of the time frame for those regulations affecting the aftermarket or the truck market, even, and you know, what do you think that means for the OEMs? Do you have a view on that?
So, if we focus on regulation specifically, which is obviously distinct to NCAP. So from the, you know, in Europe, from 2024, every new vehicle, passenger vehicle and truck is required to have drowsiness and attention warning technology. No ifs or buts. And, you know, there are some guidelines that have been published around the hurdle requirements, the entry requirements, if you like, for drowsiness and attention monitoring. And so what we're seeing is a huge interest from aftermarket customers and obviously our traditional automotive OEMs, on what are these standards and regulations going to look like? Mm. What is good DMS going to look like? Mm. And we're absolutely supporting all of our customers in those endeavours.
And are the requirements the same for passenger vehicles as for, say, trucks? I mean, is there a difference?
So from a regulation viewpoint, the requirements for what effective attention drowsiness monitoring means are the same. From a year NCAP viewpoint, and the two are really, really important, right? The regulation gets it in, and year NCAP provides the incentive for the industry to differentiate. Mm. So what year NCAP has done from 2023 is sort of set more detailed standards and guidelines on what effective distraction and drowsiness monitoring looks like. So we have a really good idea what that looks like for passenger cars from 2023. It's yet to be evolved for the heavy vehicles, but I would imagine, there'll be a huge overlap there. And obviously our core technology is developed to address both.
Mm. So we've been directly involved with the European Commission and Euro NCAP. We've had a long-term relationship and an advisory role there. Now, with that experience in mind, let me just shift to the US. I mean, so where do you see us in terms of our participation in the regulatory environment in that new geography, and how are we sort of going about it there based on what we've learnt in Europe?
So look, with regard to the US, we're very much hoping to, replicate some of the successes we've seen in Europe. President Biden last year announced the infrastructure bill, which required the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration to pursue, approaches to mitigate distracted and drunk driving. We are actively engaged with key safety bodies in the United States. We actually just recently signed an MOU with NHTSA, really to help the information sharing, just as we did, with the European agencies. And really continue that success. And we do have support on the ground in Washington, engaging directly with the regulators, with the safety bodies, and the politicians. So we're absolutely geared up to hopefully have a similar impact as we have in Europe.
Yeah, that's great. Yes, I mean if we look at let's say the take-up rate of DMS, and now of course occupant monitoring in Europe versus the US. They're pretty much on par. Different drivers. So in Europe, obviously Euro NCAP. In the US, it's really been driven by the take up of technology delivering increased levels of autonomous driving. Yeah. That being said, what do you think the time frame is for the regulations catching up with Europe and really just pushing this US market into more of a mandate? Do you see that happening anytime soon?
So NHTSA in the United States has until 2026 to decide if they're going to develop a rule for distracted driving, new technologies to address distracted driving. And so what they've just done is they've called for information from academics, industry on what is possible. We absolutely submitted into that process, a very detailed submission that anyone can read on the NHTSA website, very strongly advocating for a camera-based approach to support distracted driving and drunk driving. And, we have our view, but I mean, researchers and industry people have been saying for decades that the best way to track, the state of a person with regard to what's capturing their attention and whether they're drowsy is via a camera. And that's exactly why the regulations are all pointing in that direction, in Europe, and now there's some great signs in the United States.
Mm. So one of the other big differences in the US that I see is this focus on impairment and drunk driving in particular. And there's a lot of discussion in the industry at the moment about, which technologies can perform the task at hand and solve the problem. And, we have a view which I'll ask you to talk about. But can you also talk a little bit about some of the complications in the other technologies that have been proposed, like whether it be breath or touch or what have you? Can you give us a bit of insight into that versus what we're talking about with the camera?
Yeah. So I guess when it comes to some of these really long-standing road safety issues like drunk driving, drowsy driving, you know, they're very complex human behavior issues. Now we've seen these coming for years, right? We've been working on drowsiness for over 10 years. We've been thinking about intoxication and impairment for several years. So we've seen this coming. So we're well positioned in terms of what we think we can offer to the market when the RFQs start arriving in the next year or two or beyond. And I guess the real advantage of a camera-based sensing is that it gives you a higher degree of confidence in what it is you're detecting. So if you're measuring, for example, behavior via steering wheel input, right? So what's causing that? Is it because you're momentarily distracted? Or are you falling asleep? And the vehicle response in those two situations is likely to be very different, right? So imagine if you had a sensor like that pulled the car over every time it thought something was wrong. Anytime it thought you weren't safe.
Probably wouldn't sell many of those cars.
I don't think so. And this is what we're finding. Right? We're finding this huge interest from the OEMs, not only in delivering the right safety outcome, but also doing it in a way that provides a very good driver experience. And providing a very good driver experience largely comes down to be very sure about what it is you're detecting. The difference between distraction, drowsiness, intoxication, and other impairment. You know, we need to give the OEM the flexibility to handle the vehicle responses very differently to each of those. And I think that, you know, the camera-based approach really is the only way you can do that at the moment.
Fantastic. Look, Mike, it's been a pleasure discussing these things with you. Thanks very much.
Cheers, Paul.
See ya.